So in terms of the more distal components of the upper limb skeletal muscle, let's talk about the hand. And this is a fairly complex muscle. There are a lot of muscles in this region, depending on, but they're more compartmentalized. So we'll discuss compartments, and hopefully it won't be too overwhelming. So two terms I want you to know right off the bat, thenar and hypothenar. Thenar is indicating muscles associated with your first digit, or the thumb, and then hypothenar associated with your fifth digit or your pinky finger. And really, it's important to know the difference, and they have a separate innervation. Most of the muscles of the hand are going to be innervated by the ulnar nerve. Hypothenar is similar to that. The thenar compartment has its own individualized innervation, which is your median nerve, specifically the recurrent branch. So if you have damage to just the median nerve, it's not going to affect most of the muscles of the hand, just associated with your first digit. And one thing I want to note here is that we use the same terms in terms of the actions of the thenar compartment. So you use flexion, extension, abduction, and adduction, but the planes by which these movements occur are different than what we typically think. So if you look at flexion and extension, you can see that if in anatomical position, these are going to be moving in the frontal or coronal plane, which is opposite of what it typically does. So how I always remember this, if you think of extension, I think of loser, that's extension of your thenar compartment, whereas flexion, you're moving this way. With abduction and adduction, this is going to be in the sagittal plane. And I always think for abduction, if you like puppet hands like this, I'm abducting my thenar compartment. And then adducting is just going back towards more anatomical position. Now, one thing that makes primates unique is the opposable thumb. So the ability to kind of combine a lot of these movements and specific joints within this region to allow for you to reach across and be able to pick things up. It's a big part of being able to pick things up. So unique to primates. All right, if we reflect those muscles out of the way, those more superficial muscles, we're getting into the lumbrical muscles. And lumbrical muscles are really unique in terms of their flexor digitorum profundus attachment. And you can see in this specific visual here, your profundus tendon's moving into the digit region to attach to your distal phalanges. And you have these worm-like muscles right here that are going to have a proximal attachment to the profundus tendons and then a distal attachment in order to be able to affect your MP joints, which are your metacarpophalangeal joints. It's going to flex these, so flexing your knuckles, and extend your IP joints, okay? So your proximal interphalangeal and your distal interphalangeal. Deep to the lumbrical muscles and the deepest muscles of the hand are going to be your interossei muscle, and that makes sense. They're going to be in between your ossei or your bones. Now your dorsal interossei muscles, which are what you can see here, are going to allow for you to abduct your digits, okay? Abduct your digits, 2 through 5, not including 1. Whereas your palmar, which we don't have a visual of here, these are going to allow for you to adduct, all right? Now, when we're talking about by which plane or which digit we're abducting or adducting by, this is going to be your third digit, okay? So this digit right here, that's you're moving away from the third digit or back to the third digit. And similar to most muscles of the hand, these are going to be innervated by the ulnar nerve.